Welcome back to another episode of Get Swifty. My name's Bo, and this time around we're going to be learning some SwiftUI by following along with Apple's online tutorials. Let's get to it. Okay, the first thing you'll want to do is go to developer.apple.com/tutorials/SwiftUI. And apparently this is going to take us 4.5 hours, but I will speed through some of it for the sake of the video. SwiftUI is a modern way to declare user interfaces for any Apple platform. Create beautiful, dynamic apps faster than ever before. Now, the only thing you need is a Mac and the latest version of Xcode installed in order to follow along with this tutorial. And I guess we'll start at the very beginning, which is creating and combining views. Cool, create a new project and explore the canvas. So let's do that. So I'm going to call this one SwiftUI Tutorial. Make sure I've got SwiftUI selected. My cycle is SwiftUI app, and the language is Swift. I'm going to leave core data and include tests unchecked. For those of us who are new to Xcode, let's have a quick look around. On the left side here, you've got your file navigation. In the middle section here, we have our code. And over here, we have our SwiftUI previews. And on the far right, we have what is called an attributes inspector. And this is the first thing we'll be looking at. We can customize the text by writing some code in here, so we can make it bold, and that will bold the font. But we can also customize it by making changes in the attributes inspector on this side. So I can change the font to perhaps large title. There we go. And change the weight of it here as well. And I can change the color. Now, if you want to remove any of these changes, you can just hit the little cross in this little blue circle on the far right. There we go. Now, so inherited color is just the color that gets inherited from its surrounding view. So this content view, whatever the color is set on that, that's what color the text will get. Now, the guide is telling us to command click on our text view. Doing so will present a context-aware list of actions. But the one that we're going to be focusing on right now is Show SwiftUI Inspector. Now this will show a pop-up in this view, which is very similar to the one on this side here. You can see they're pretty much identical. So what we could really do is just close the side panel completely and pop up these actions just when we need them. So what I'm going to do is reset all these changes that we've put in back to normal. Okay, so we want to set the text to Turtle Rock. If you have a landmark near home that you'd prefer to use, you can do that. And we'll change the font modifier to title. And we'll change the foreground color to green. Why not? Now, it does mention in the tutorial that we can change this by hand over this side. So we can change the color to red, to green. All right, now onto section 3. We will be combining multiple text views into a stack. Now the stack we'll be using is a horizontal one, and it seems like we're going to be having a H stack with our text on the left, a spacer in the middle, and then more text on the right. So to do that, we will command click here and we'll say embed in VStack. And what that's done is just wrapped our text object in this VStack. All right, how do we add another text view? You can do that through code, and we can put our text through here, or we can hit this plus button up here, type text in the search, we can grab this, and we can drag it. Now we can drop it into our code, like this, or we can drop it into our preview. We can decide where we want that to go, yeah? You can see these little blue highlights show up, and that indicates where this text view will be dropped. So I think according to the design, it needs to go below, and we can do that. And we'll set the font to subheadline. Just going to make some edits here to remove that bold. There we go. That looks a bit more like what Apple's going for. Now in our preview screen, we can see that this text is centered, and we want to left align it. We can do that by setting the alignment to leading on the VStack. And you can see now that our preview is updated to reflect that change. Now what we'll do next is embed this subheadline that we've created into a HStack. You can see how code has now updated, but our preview looks pretty much the same. So what we'll do now is we'll add a spacer, and I believe they're going to get us to do another text field afterwards. So let's take a look. Yep, looks like that's the case here, and it is California. Okay, now you can see that we've got a little bit of a problem here where this spacer has no dimensions set on it, and it is pushing our elements to the very far side of the screen. So the solution for this is to add some padding. Okay, so we'll open up our assets folder, and in here we will create a new image. Drag that into the middle for the 2x, and Xcode's smart enough to use this image for both 3x and 1x as well. And these numbers kind of relate to the pixel density of your device. There isn't really many 1x devices around anymore. This was like the resolution on the original iPhone and the early iPads. 2x is what most people are probably using these days, and 3x is more like your plus phones and stuff like that, your plus devices. Okay, so going back to our code, we're going to create a new file called CircleImage. Okay, so while we can just drop an image in here, we're creating this separate file so that we can keep our code a little bit more modular, right? So we might want to reuse this CircleImage in other areas of our app, and the good way of doing that is to split it out from our main interface. We can consider this like a text view or another button type or something like that, like the ones that Apple already pre-supplies for us. All we're doing is creating our own. Okay, so now what Apple wants us to do is put in an image with the name of Turtle Rock, that image we just imported. And we can do that. We can go image. And there we go. There's our image in our preview. It looks great. And we are going to round it off. And let's put a border around that. Now, shapes are also a type of view. We can use them directly in our code. And now we'll add a shadow to it. This is how easy it is. You just compose all these little things together, and you can see on the right-hand side there in the preview, it just keeps building up. All right, so now we're up to section 5, and it seems like we're gonna be starting to work on some map stuff. So we'll start with a new custom view. And we'll call it MapView. And we'll import MapKit. Okay, so I'm just going to copy this code across because there's a lot of numbers and stuff to type in. So what this is doing is creating a region to render on the map. So you've got your coordinate, which will be the center point of the map. That could be anywhere in the world. And the span will be how far zoomed into the map we are. And we can put our map down here. And I'll hit resume. According to Apple, when previews are in static mode, they only fully render native SwiftUI views. For the map view, you'll need to switch to a live preview to see it render. How do we switch to a live preview? We just hit this little play button. And have a look. Okay, we'll hit stop. All right, so it looks like in section 6, we're actually going to be putting all these elements together. So let's go back to our content view. All right, it looks like here they want us to embed this into another stack view. And we can do that just from our code by holding down command and clicking on. You can see these highlights that pop up. So we command click, and we can go down here, and we can say embed in VStack. So now we have a VStack within a VStack within a VStack. And up here, we'll put our custom map view. We'll set the frame height because it's taking up way too much space up here. And when you get a frame, you got all these options to choose from. You can set the width and height and its alignment. but we just want to change the height right now. Setting just the height would leave the width at infinity, which means it can stretch to fill whatever space is available. And of course, we can live preview that. It looks like just underneath the map view, we will put our circle image. Looks okay, but it's not perfect. I think what we want to do is overlap these a little bit. So we can set an offset. Again, if we only set one of these parameters, the other one will stay at zero. In this case, x will be zero. Y is minus 130. How do we get to 130? Well, it's just the size. I guess that's what Apple has calculated out as being the size of this image in this view, in the circle, and half of it. Next one is padding. Now, of course, we just set padding like before, but this time we are going to set it to the bottom. And we want to do minus 130 because what that's going to do is bring this this title element here, all this text up closer to this image. And of course, it still looks a little bit weird because we've got all this space at the top, all this space at the bottom. That's because this entire thing is being centered on the screen. And to push it up, we can just do what we did here to push these two text views apart. We just put a spacer. Here we go. Now it's at the top of the screen. And finally, all right, so what does this do? See, if I comment it out, you can see that this little space at the top appears, and if I add that code in, it disappears. So all that's doing is telling the device to ignore this spacing, this safe area at the top. Now, the reason why I have this safe area is so that we don't get things cut off, right? So this is automatically done for us because of this notch, okay? So on older devices, it's not really a thing. We don't have to worry about it. We can put our content to the very top of the screen. But because we've got this notch in the way, there are sometimes elements that we don't want to extend up into that area. So if we had the text at the top instead of the map, we would probably keep that area at the top. We'll probably keep that space there. But because it's just a map and it's some sort of an image, and it doesn't matter if we lose some little bit of information up there, we can pull that content back up, and it makes it a lot cleaner to look at. Okay, so it looks like they want us to add a divider here. Yep, you can see this little line that has just appeared, and we're going to put some extra information about this location. And we'll want that a title. Now, you may have noticed that both of these text views have the same modifier applied, the same sub-headline modifier. What we can do is actually remove those. Okay, you see the content update on the right, and you can set the font here instead. And that updates all the content inside this H-stack. So this H-stack has a font modifier applied to it. It's not text or anything like that, but what it will do is it'll pass on this modifier to the content inside. So you can do other things too, like set the foreground color. All right, so this will change the font color. You notice that both of them have been updated. I kind of like the look of it as blue, but Apple want us to do secondary. Okay, so some things to note in this first version. They do go through creating separate views, like separate custom views. So we've got our circle image and our map view. Normally when you're building out an app for views like this, you wouldn't necessarily put the actual image name in the image for this, unless it's like an icon or something like that, and it's going to be reused multiple times throughout your app. When it comes to photos, it might be the user image, and in that case, you're probably pulling it from an online service, in which case, for something like circle image, we may be passing in something like an image name, right? And then we would set it up here like this, and we can change the image depending on where it's being used in the app. Same thing goes for this map view. We wouldn't want to hard code this value in here, these coordinates. We want to be able to change them. So if we have a list of places, but I think in future tutorials, they're going to go through that with us. So that's fine. So one other thing we haven't spoken about yet is this state property wrapper. And what that does is it tells the system to redraw the view anytime that changes. So in this example, we have our region, And if we change the coordinates of our region or the size of the viewing window of it, we want the screen to redraw itself. So Swift isn't, like, the app's not gonna know to do that until we tell it to, right? Now this state property saves us a lot of work. So instead of updating region and then saying view, redraw, it just happens automatically. Once the region's updated, it'll redraw the view and everything will just work. It'll even apply any animations that we've had set on them. So that's it. With this video series, I plan to go in a little bit more depth than what Apple does in their tutorials. And if you're the kind of person who finds it difficult to learn through reading and find it much easier through video content, then this is the series for you. Please subscribe and then you'll get notified of when the next update comes out. Yeah, that's it for today.